time that comes up with the recording now. So when that, when you see that hitting like 6 minutes or so,
that's when you, okay.
That's probably.
So Charlie, I figure, I'm sure Mike will talk to you, but I'll say a little something, sort of set the stage for it, and then I'll say I was intrigued by the salary issue that came up. And I think I,
right.
I'll figure out, I don't think I'll say too much then. I think I'll throw it open to you. I'll mention that I did a piece about this, about, how should I do that? Well, we'll just play it by ear, but I'll do a little intro about how this all came about. And then, we've both written about this subject of compensation to some degree. And,
I'll just warn him that you're going to start out just by saying your name and Commonwealth. So he should be ready to.
Yeah. When you first talk, make sure you say who you are and where you're from.
Okay. Sure.
Okay. Yeah. I'll do the same on this end.
But right. What I'm thinking is you say, you know, hi, and I'm Bruce Mall, blah, 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 and then he says,
oh, right at the
himself,
beginning.
And then you can start. Do you get it?
Did you get it, John?
Yeah. Okay. I got it.
All right, I'm just going to move out of the way, and whenever you want to go.
So it's going now?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, I'm Bruce Mall, the editor of Commonwealth Magazine.
And I'm Charlie Chipio, the principal of Chipio Strategies.
We're talking today about a story that broke last week, actually. It involved Jeff Mullen, the Secretary of Transportation. The Globe reported that he had approached the governor last May and asked for a pay raise. The governor turned him down, and so he had told the governor that he was going to be leaving. This wouldn't have been very big news, except the news broke at a time when the Transportation Department was in a lot of controversy about falling light fixtures in the Big Dig tunnels. So it became very big news, but the actual issue of pay and compensation was turned out to be a minor part of the furor. But that's what really interested me about this story, is that Jeff Mullen, the Secretary of Transportation, makes $150,000 a year. He was asking for a pay raise, and the governor turned him down. By all accounts, the governor has a lot of faith in Jeff Mullen and thinks he's the right person for the job, but he still turned him down and is going to lose him at some point this year. And it raises an interesting issue. It's our cover story in the magazine right now is focused on this issue of pay and compensation at state authorities and in government in general. And it's a fascinating issue about, do you pay people in government what they would be worth in the private sector? Or do you pay them some salary based on the fact that they should be providing some public service and working for less than they would in the private sector? What do you think, Charlie?
Well, you know, I think it depends who you want to get, right? I mean, the reality is that there's a lot of us who would be willing to work for less than what we might make in the private sector, but we also, there's a lot of us who are very interested in government and public service who don't necessarily have the wherewithal to work for dramatically less than we could get in the private sector. And I think that's what makes it such a fine line and such an interesting dance. You know, I think the bigger issue here is whoever thought that this whole Marion Walsh issue would ripple so much through the administration. I mean, to me, so much of this goes back to that issue of announcing that Marion Walsh was going to get the, I think, $175,000 a year job at HEFA that hadn't been filled for a decade. And a lot of this certainly strikes me as a reaction to that.
Yeah, she was being offered initially a job of $175,000, as you point out, and the governor and his aides were orchestrating that salary initially. But now the governor is balking at giving his Secretary of Transportation with much bigger responsibility a raise above $150,000. And so there's been an amazing transformation within the governor's office on this thing.
And I think a troubling one because, you know, The piece I did on this was last spring. I did a piece on, you know, this is the classic, you know, man bites dog piece, right? I did a piece about, you know, sort of really knocking the governor for Jim Rooney's pay cut at the convention center. Now, me, who's always knocking the convention center, the fact of the matter is that I may think that you know, we shouldn't expand the size of our convention center, but anybody who looks at it realistically knows that Jim Rooney is one of the best public managers we've got, and we need more Jim Rooneys. And this whole populist thing of, well, you know, no one's going to make any extra money off, you know, while I'm here, I'm going to really sort of crunch down on all this stuff. Well, in the end, I think a lot of times you end up with managers who aren't as competent and people who aren't as competent, and it ends up costing you twice as much. You know, I think the big issue for me in this, in public sector salaries, is more one about accountability. You know, let's pay the ones that are good more, you know, so that we can keep them and they can keep doing a good job. I really think you hit the issue very well on the cover of the magazine. You know, with the life science, the woman who runs the life science is making what, $285,000, and Rich Davey, who by all accounts is doing a great job at the T under, you know, pretty much the most difficult circumstances you can ever imagine. You know, he's making dramatically, I don't know, making 140 or 150 or something like that. Whatever it is, it's certainly dramatically less than MBTA general managers have made in the past, which is, as I remember it, you know, well into the 200,000s. So, I mean, we're lucky that we got a Rich Davey. I'm not sure how many Rich Davies there are out there if we keep just saying we're just not going to pay anybody for anything.
Yeah, and the it raises the whole issue of why is the Patrick administration taking this approach? Because they, at the time of the Marion Walsh controversy, they did appoint a commission to look at salaries at state authorities, and that commission came back and said the salaries are generally okay. There were some perks that accompanying these jobs that they had problems with. But the Patrick folks have taken that report and just basically rewritten the ending now, and they say that they are addressing the concerns raised by the so-called Crosby Commission about excessive salaries. And so why do you think they're doing this? They seem to be taking a report that says one thing and doing the other, and as you say, they end up with these inconsistent policies, paying some people more, some people less. Doesn't seem to make sense.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. And I actually read that report, and you certainly don't come away from reading that point getting the sense that that what he was saying was that these folks are dramatically overpaid. That was not the case at all. I think so often what you find is the reality in state government that a lot of people are not overpaid. You know, they kind of get a lot of nice perks that you and I might want to get. But I just have to think, you know, I don't have any insight as to say that, you know, this is what it is, but putting two and two together, my sense is that times have changed since that all first happened. You know, we're in very tough times now. You've got to be seen as a budget cutter, and I think every governor has got to be in a position to try to show their fiscal conservative bona fides, and one way to do it is this populist approach that says, well, you know, it's real tough times for you, and so we're going to make sure all these folks don't get paid very much as well. But that across the board approach, I think, is very dangerous in terms of maintaining the expertise you need, particularly to navigate through times like these when there is not a lot of margin for error.
And there's another school of thought, too, that the governor, with all these state authorities, there's another recurring theme that they were all doing their own thing, and they were operating a bit too independently of the rest of state government. And Patrick has made it a practice of basically putting his own people in charge of these authorities as he's gained control of the boards through his appointments. And now they make no secret of it. They're trying to weave these authorities into state government, basically. You know,
that's a very good point. And I would argue that, you know, certainly in my memory, and I've probably been paying attention to this stuff for 20, 25 years, I've never seen an administration that is more interested in essentially, you know, controlling everything. I mean, it really is remarkable, down from you know, eliminating the, starting with eliminating the independence of the State Board of Education and the whole education, you know, bureaucracy through all of the independent authorities. And I think to me it speaks to this kind of amazing, this amazing malady that so many governors and public officials have, which is essentially that they think that time started at the moment that they put their hand on the Bible and took the oath of office. And the reality is that there have been good reasons for some of the independence that both some of these agencies and some of these independent authorities have had. And I'm a little bit concerned about just sort of willy-nilly just saying, no, we need to streamline everything. I need to be in control of everything. There's reasons why one person's not in control of everything. And so, generally speaking, I think that's a very important point and one that troubles me a little bit.
Yeah, and the governor's critics sort of say that the reason he's been so insistent about reducing salaries is because that helps force out the people who are at these authorities who he did not appoint. And then he sort of promotes from within at a lower salary. And so he, as you put it, he wins this populist support by slashing salaries and benefits, but at the same time gets his own people in place. Now, the Patrick folks vehemently deny that that's their intent, but the governor's critics say that's the outcome, and right, it's a very real outcome.
Well, that's right. And you know, we can all sort of make guesses about intent. Who knows? But in terms of the outcome, that is the outcome. And as I said earlier, you know, sometimes you win. Sometimes you get a rich Davy who's willing to take a job at a much lower pay than his predecessors did. On the other hand, then you end up with these situations like Jeff Mullen. Now, apparently today, Jeff Mullen is saying it's not about, it was, you know, in those famous words of MoveOn, it's not about the money. You know, who knows what it's about or what it's not about. What I would say is that, I think the other issue here is the sheer number of transportation secretaries that this administration has gone through. And in addition to that job being bigger than ever with having to now consolidate, and sort of actually implement this transportation reform that puts so many of these agencies, under one roof, it's a very important time. And you don't ever want to be having that much turnover in that office anyway. But, you know, especially now when the work is so important and it's such a big job. And, you know, you had somebody in Jeff Mullen who, you know, I would have my occasional disagreements with him and things like that, but I think most people think he's a real competent guy, you know, who did a pretty good job. And, you know, I don't know. I don't know who replaces him. And that's problematic.
I think I'm all set. How about you, Charlie?
I have nothing else to say that's worth listening to.
I think we're all set, Michael. All right, great.
Great.
He says he's got nothing more, so we're talked out.
I gotta run and take my son to the doctor.
All right, thank you.